Hey, everybody, this is Ham Radio Now, the world's most important amateur radio. I screwed that up. Hey, everybody, this is Ham. I'm going to leave that other part in there. This is Ham Radio Now, the most important amateur radio program, podcast, TV show, whatever you want to call it, on the internet. And this is episode 335. Fix it. Fix it. Here are a pair of co-hosts. I am surrounded by co-hosts. The most recent of the co-hosts is on my right, on screen left. Hey, David.
Hey, how's it going, Gary?
I'm doing good. How are things in California? Have you gotten cooler yet?
No. Well, it's now it's high 80s, low 90s. It's not over in three digits, so it's better.
Cooler, not better. Cool, cooler.
Yeah. All right. It's workable to be in the studio right now without the fan. Last time we did it, I had to have the fan going.
So you're not air conditioned in the garage there?
No, not in the garage, sadly. Someday.
Okay. On my left, screen right, the former and occasional and intermittent co-host. Hey, Jeffy.
Hey, Jeff, AC4ZO. Happy to be in the air-conditioned studio. David, I'm sorry. There's no air conditioning. I hope it doesn't get too uncomfortable for you there. You're good?
No. Okay. Yeah, we're good here.
All right. So I'm going to try piping it through the internet to you, and maybe that will help cool you down.
Excellent.
So the title of this episode is going to be Fix It. And there we go. I think I've got something to, yes. this is way too much work, more work than it's worth, but.
Well, so what do we do? Well, it's actually very simple. Somebody needs to get on top of the situation and fix it.
Well, that's all. That's all. All I was going for.
Okay.
Nice sound bite.
Yeah. I like it.
And back to David in the screen. I'm the technical director, and normally I would have a camera pointed at me and all the stuff, but that camera is that, like I said, I don't know where the buttons are. That camera is pointed there.
It was one.
Okay. Camera one. I'm going to push a button here, and I think it's going to put the three shot back up.
There you go. I'm
going to learn how this works.
That's pretty interesting.
So this is a rare smoke and solder-ish episode.
Well, we're going to talk about it.
Well, I mean, the smoke and the solder are all in history, but you know, even on Ham Nation, they don't do their smoke and solder live very much. It's, you know, it's all Memorex. But I've got hints of things that were actually smoked and soldered. I guess that's you doing.
Yeah, that's me.
I guess I'll explain the vague background of what went on.
All right.
I've got an ICOM 7000. That's this radio here. That's the Q-Mobile's mobile radio. And a few years ago, I started having trouble with it, tuning the tuning dial. And Jeff is going to find that camera first someday. The tuning dial, of course, tunes the frequency. And it also adjusts a lot of other things. Mic gain, CTCSS tones, all kinds of things. It is an important dial. And it stopped working under relatively specific conditions. And I think the specific conditions I didn't understand very well at first. Oh, and by the way, we're going to talk about fixing that radio, but we're also going to talk about general troubleshooting and repair kind of stuff, which is what you do all day, every day. but not in ham radio.
No.
Sadly.
No. I would like to, but hams don't want to pay a lot for that. Well, my boss doesn't pay either. A lot either.
Right? Well, I'm not going to pay a lot for this technician. we looked at it actually maybe 2 years ago. I don't know if you recall. I brought it over to your shack.
I don't remember.
Well, the problem developed in the heat of summer, and the radio was hot. and the display sits under the windshield, so it can get direct sun. It can get really hot in there. We when we were testing things, I think we measured 113.
Oh, I do remember that. Yeah, yeah,
yeah. Well, this was this current around once we fixed it.
Right.
I remember.
That's right.
Yeah, we.
See, 3 weeks ago, 3 years ago, it's all the same.
Yeah. Well, we wanted to, just out of curiosity, measure.
Yeah, I remember taking a thermometer into the car.
I think, what did it hit, 113 or something?
I think so, yeah. So, and that after just a couple of minutes with a partly cloudy sky.
Yeah. So in the heat of summer, it's the tuning dial stopped. If Jeff were to tune it, nothing would happen.
Just stay put.
Just nothing at all?
Yeah.
That was it?
Nothing. And nothing.
And even if you went through the memories, it was gone.
Right. Nothing on any of the other functions. You couldn't adjust the mic gain, couldn't adjust anything else. So,
well, the memories worked if you didn't have to bring them up with the knob, right?
Right. Yeah. The memories are switched by another switch.
And so the radio is okay. It's just the pot.
Yeah. And in fact, you can tune the radio, up and down the band by, using the up and down buttons on the microphone. Grab that mic. And if you can see it's in memory mode. So you're stepping through the memories.
Yeah. Those were big steps. Let's see. Where's the BFO mode?
It's going to be a lot faster if I just go over there and push the button. Oh yeah. It's on the mic.
Well, mode switch the,
that's which the, yeah. The,
yeah.
Now there'll be a VFO button.
There it is.
No. Okay.
I'll do it. I'll just step right over here and
not do it on the mic.
Nah, he don't need no stinking microphone.
There you go.
There you go. You're in VFO.
Oh, there we are.
Oh, there you go.
Yeah.
That's the slow way to do it though.
Yeah.
If you hold it down, will it skip a long way? Or just there you go. So it's faster that way.
Yeah. And you can set what that step is going to be, but that's I think 100 hertz.
Yeah.
And that's about as big a step as you want to make. It looks like 50 hertz.
Yeah, it looks like 50. Fives.
Yeah. Yeah. 50 hertz is that's, you know, sideband can be tuned in 50 hertz increments and sound about right.
Usable.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
So those were the symptoms, and that's about as far as I had diagnosed it initially. So we took it into your house.
Yep.
And we took...
You actually knew one other tidbit of information that was very helpful about it.
Well, was that 3 years ago, or was that this time?
That was this time.
Yeah, okay. Well, I learned a lot.
Well, everything I only remember this time, so...
Okay. 3 years ago... just about what we have described now is about all I remembered.
The tidbit that I found particularly useful was you recalled that as it was beginning to fail, you could push the knob off to one side and make it work for a little while longer.
Yeah, a little physical.
Until it got just a little warmer, and then that was it.
Yep. But 3 years ago, I didn't know that.
Mm-hmm.
And as far as I was concerned, it stopped working. It was dead. The heat... I might have started to get an inkling that it was thermal, but no, not really, because we brought it inside, powered it up, and it worked. Mm-hmm. Everything was fine. We gave up.
It worked fine.
It worked fine.
Yeah.
So we said, well, if it ain't broke, you can't fix it.
That's right.
Fix it. You can't. Hang on.
Is that one? Yeah, you have a detachable head?
Yeah, it does.
Yeah, okay.
If it ain't broke, you can't.
It's left in 2 weeks. Somebody needs to look at this mess and fix it.
if it ain't broke, you can't fix it. That should get me bounced from YouTube pretty quick.
Is it in your car? Is the head separated, or is it all together?
It is separated. The radio is under the back seat.
Yeah.
So, I put it back in the car, and of course. It died again.
Got hot.
After a while. After a while. So then we started to realize it's thermal, and I started to poke and prod and do other stuff. And that's when I discovered that if you pushed probably the toward the upper right, from the lower left to the upper right, you could mechanically make it work a little bit for a while until it got a bunch hotter. And then it stopped again.
Yeah.
Why did it take 3 years? I'm busy.
Well, yeah, you were making videos.
Well, for one thing, it was only a problem in the summer. You know, around here, summer is June, July, August, September.
Yeah.
It worked pretty good until middle of May.
You normally park in the garage too, right?
Yeah, most places.
So 50% of the time when you get in the car, even in the heat, it would work fine.
Yeah. And and where it sat in the car, you guys have seen the on-the-road shows. It's right in front of the air conditioning vents.
Yeah.
So you just crank the air conditioning low and pour the air on it, and in 10, 15 minutes, it's working again. So when you
now that's when it's been sitting outside somewhere other than your house.
When it stopped working totally dead.
Yeah.
And when you've got to work around like that, sometimes it takes a little while to figure things out.
Yeah, I hold the GPS in front of the thing till it cools off enough that the screen comes on.
So but yeah, we're heading into summer again, and I thought let's fix it. So, you know, there's a couple of things that I was going to get prepped for the show that I didn't do, and I'm not going to take the time to do them right now. But some people are probably saying, well, why look at the schematic and, you know, learn things. Some things we did know was that what's in there that does the tuning is something called an optical encoder.
Yeah.
And back in my day... VFOs, transmitter and receiver tuning, was accomplished by adjusting a variable capacitor. Literally.
Right.
You know, great big multi-thing variable capacitor. Well, one side stays fixed and the other side tunes. And it was physically coupled to the dial, usually by a cord. Oh, I messed up a Heathkit Seneca.
The dial cord got
messed up, and I took the thing
couldn't
apart.
Couldn't figure out how to thread it.
Never worked again. So I didn't build the Seneca. Seneca is a 6 meter and 2 meter, fairly high power transmitter back in the day. So yeah, the dial was mechanically coupled. It could be with a cord. It could be with, you know, some other arrangement, but it tuned that capacitor, and that's what tuned it. Right. We haven't done that in a long time. We adjust a VFO, but you need something that's going to tell the circuitry what to do, step up and step down, and the volume control and everything else. So what does an optical encoder do?
Well, it's a switch. And this, I would barely call it an optical encoder. It's a single bit encoder. Typically, an optical encoder has a parallel output of anywhere from 4 to 20 bits or so. And what it does is it creates a digital signal based on the position of the shaft. They're used for telling, you know, what position a motor is turned to and things like that. But in this case, this encoder...
Well, no detail yet, just very... You know, we're stringing them along, working our way, dancing around the issue a little bit. So, what's optical about it? What's the optical?
Well,
thing?
What's inside the optical encoder looks like just a little metal cylinder. Most common ones are 2 inches long, 2 inches diameter, and about a dozen bits, about 12 bits. And what's in there is a glass disc with a bunch of concentric.
You see, David. I asked Jeff what time it was, and he's building me a watch.
It's all right.
Oh, so I thought your question was, what's in there?
No, what is optical?
What's optical? Inside there is a disc, and on one side of the disc is an LED, on the other side of the disc is a phototransistor, and then the disc has some marks that can obscure it. And so when the encoder rotates, it's rotating a disc with some notches on it.
I've got pictures. I didn't want to show the pictures yet, which is why I didn't want
Jeff
to go. Well,
that's a typical encoder. That's not this encoder. This encoder is much more rudimentary than that.
Yeah. So as we were wondering about this, we knew it was an encoder like that.
Yeah.
But we didn't know anything else. We hadn't taken the radio apart yet.
Right.
So I was figuring things out. I was realized that it likely mechanical because you push the dial kind of hard to the side and it works a little bit until it gets a little hotter and then it stops working. And thermal. So you got some mechanical, some thermal, which is also generally mechanical.
Mechanical, right.
And then I went looking at mailing lists and websites. And
you did a lot of research.
Yeah. And lots of other people had an issue like that. And a few of them had some kinds of solutions. The number one solution, send it back to ICOM.
We're not going to do that's like asking for directions. We're not going to do that.
And I even called ICOM tech support and said, here's what's going on. Got any ideas? And they said, send it back.
Yeah, send it back, right?
Yeah.
Put it in a box. Ship it to us.
Ship it back.
Well, you know, the last thing they want you to do is
fix it.
Open up the case.
Fix it. Yeah. And this is not only at this point long out of warranty, it's long out of production.
Right.
Stop making this radio 2 years ago. So, so we got those pieces of the puzzle, but one thing we didn't know was, well, what actual device is it?
Mm-hmm. Right.
So look at the schematic parts list. It's got an ICOM part number. Doesn't help. The schematic doesn't help. I was going to show you these things, but take my word for it.
Yeah. The schematic was a little square box marked, might've been marked encoder. I don't recall.
Yeah, I think it was. And your best guess, based on seeing many devices like this, was it was going to be a sealed unit.
Mm-hmm.
Nothing you can do. No adjustments.
Right.
Replace it.
Right.
Some of those websites, long lectures about the dangers and evils of going inside your radios.
Yeah.
Long lectures about that. Yeah. David, have you ever busted a radio trying to fix it?
When we get a little bit further along into the punchline, I'm going to pull out a Yaesu I have in my Go box here, which has exactly the same problem. I almost went as far as to take it apart. I had it about halfway apart. Actually, I had it apart out to the board, and I have the part number of the pot that needs to be replaced because it does basically the same thing. You turn it, and sometimes it goes, and sometimes it doesn't, and there's actually a good YouTube video out there showing that if you're really, really brave, you can take the pot apart and clean its copper contacts, and the copper contacts get dirty or worn. Or you can just get the new pot and just solder it out and solder it back in. But I hadn't gone that far.
Astute viewers of the program will notice that I did not fix it. That guy over there fixed it because he knows how. Knows all this stuff. Okay, so back to the mailing lists. Absorbed the lectures and recommendations to send it back. And then finally somebody pointed me to something halfway useful. There was a guy on a Yahoo ICOM 7000 mailing list who had taken his radio apart, the front panel apart. We're not going to do that on the show live. No, thank you.
Come on.
Yeah. The toolbox is right down there to your left, Jeff.
Well, it looks like it's working good now though.
Yeah. It is. And except for the other thing, we'll get to the other thing in a little bit.
Oh, yeah.
So this is a good point to mention because now is the first time I thought of it. Ham Radio Now is brought to you by you. If you enjoy the program, get something out of it. Stop by hamradionow.tv and see Arvin there on the website or see Arvin there on the West Coast.
What? Oh, no, no, no.
He's got an Arvin. Somewhere.
Oh, he's got
over there.
Yeah.
Oh, I see him up top there.
And Jeff. Yep.
Can I get one too?
You got Jeff get one. Yeah.
All right.
You get the stunt, Arvin.
Yep. Everybody gets an Arvin. Your desk is going to get a little.
We can pick him up on the radio cam.
Yeah, your desk is going to get a little crowded. Oh, see his feet.
Criminy.
That's okay.
He might have to sit where the dummy load was. Oh, he can sit in front of the radio.
Oops. Yep.
There we go.
You can put him right on the radio.
Mm.
And pull the radio a little closer.
Nah, he's too tall.
That you see that stuff that's sitting underneath the radio that's keeping things from sliding?
Yep. Mm-hmm.
That's interesting stuff, he said in a squirrel-type diversion. That is kitchen counter drainer. Put dishes on it and stuff, and it's got little holes in it. But back behind me on the shelves, there's a lot of radios that the shelves are wood and the radios are metal and they like to slide. And you got one sitting there, and I don't want to screw them down to the shelf. So you grab the microphone and you lean a little bit a ways and you pull a radio off the shelf. So that is it's not sticky, but nothing slides.
It's kind of tacky. I put telegraph keys on it. Stops them from running around the bench.
Yeah. So you can get it at a lot of kitchen stores, at Big Hunk from Bed Bath and Beyond. And so just, little tip from Ham Radio Now. If you find that tip worthwhile, stop by hamradionow.tv.
Okay.
Click the pig. Hmm. I forget where I was.
We were talking about you had come across the tidbit.
Okay, yeah, the tidbit was that a guy had taken his radio apart,
yeah,
and lifted the encoder off of the board and pulled it out through the hole where the dial had been that he had to pull off, and he found two adjustment pots on his.
Right.
And he said his wasn't working, and he said by adjusting one of those pots, it started working again. So I'm thinking, well, maybe that's the problem with mine. But at the very least, we know when we go in, we're going to be able to get the thing out.
Right.
He didn't describe the unit at all. He didn't describe the encoder.
I'm very proud of him anyway.
Yeah. But he told me what I needed to know to say, okay, let's go into this thing.
Yeah. Did he tell you which of the two pots to adjust?
He adjusted both. Okay. He didn't know what they did, and we don't know what they did.
Awesome.
But we adjusted them. So now I guess we can look at some of the pictures here.
Did it help?
Well, I think it was more preventive than a help.
Oh. Yep. So let's see. That is
the body of the encoder. It's just a metal case, and what you're seeing in there is a disc that has some holes around it. I guess it was I didn't count them, but I would guess 45 holes or so.
Yeah.
Around it.
So we had gone into the radio and discovered that it is not sealed.
Yeah.
It was highly visible.
Yeah.
And you could get into it and I wish I had shot video now, since things are so successful. Shooting video of things when you're doing them makes them take 10 times longer.
Right.
We didn't have that much time to play.
Yeah, that piece that I'm holding right there is purely mechanical. And even the shaft was removed from that. We were looking for anything that could be goofy about it. So that next picture, Gary, what you have is one hand's got that metal case and the other hand the shaft with the disc on it. And there's the little clips and rings and stuff where what holds the whole thing together. There you can see the holes in the disc quite well.
Yeah. Well, even a better picture, I think. Yeah. And if you just look around, Jeff has got the magnifying glasses and all the right tools. And, way more than I do. So, because you do this
every day. Yeah.
See? Okay. And now we're looking through a magnifying glass, taking a picture through the magnifying glass. And now you can see the disc really well.
That worked really well.
Yeah. So the thing in the middle is the shaft that comes out, and the knob goes on that. And so the rest of it goes on into inside the radio. This is the optical part.
Yeah.
That's a
photo interrupter.
Yep. So on one side is... I guess, is this the photo cell?
Yeah, that's the photo transistor.
Okay, and then the light source, the diode LED, is over here, and it shines from one to the other.
Right.
They even mark it as a diode on the outside there.
Yeah, they do.
Yeah.
And then the disc is going to go in there.
Passes through the slot, right?
Yeah, and as you turn it, it lights up.
Yeah, the path is obscured or unobscured. And there actually is our three phototransistors in there. If you go back in, you can see the aperture for them. And the reason there are three is so that the radio can tell.
Two of them real clearly.
Yeah, the third one's there. It's to the right, and it's fainter. The reason there are three of them, maybe there were two. I can't remember. But the reason for it is.
Wait, let me show how smart I am.
Okay.
So the radio knows which way you're turning the dial. Because if it just went on and off, it wouldn't know whether you're tuning up or down.
Right.
But by seeing one side or the other go first, knows which way which way it's going. Boy, aren't I smart.
Yes.
You didn't even tell me that before. You
know it. That was good. That was really good.
Knew it. Let's see what else we got here. Okay, well, there's...
There it is assembled. You can see the photo interrupter kind of... in a horseshoe shape over the disc, and then the disc can obscure and unobscure the path as it rotates.
Yep.
The two potentiometers or variable resistors Gary was talking about are on the other side of that small circuit board where the photo interrupter is.
On the left there, is that a ball bearing to give it tension? Ha! Is that what's in there?
That's we found out something very interesting
that's
about that.
That's the detent, The click detent.
Yep. Yeah.
Yeah, and show them
when you it's so the detent is off now. There is a lever on the side here. There we go. It's pretty dark over here, Gary.
Oh, I had a light. It's in the wrong place.
I heard something click.
There we go. Didn't help much, but let's see. There we go. Arvin just hit the floor. He'll be all right though.
Fortunately, he's the stunt Arvin.
There's a lever. This turns the detent off, and then it's got kind of a partial setting where you can feel a little bit. Oh, that actually is just some drag. And there I can feel a click, 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 click. And all it's doing is messing with the spring that puts that ball bearing, with the pressure.
Yeah. Yeah. This so it's just adjusting where that little ball bearing goes.
Yeah.
Yeah, how far it gets pushed in or out.
Yep.
Yeah.
So as you took everything apart, of course, that ball bearing wanted to go flying across the room.
We didn't let it, though. No. The bigger problem was the spring in the faceplate's case.
Yep. So here's a different look at the optical part, the diode, and the photocell. And, of course, the disc goes right in through there. So what did we discover when we pulled all that out?
Well, it with the problem, what was causing it?
Well, we made a troubleshooting. I don't call it an error, but we don't know what solved the problem because we did three things.
Well,
without putting it back together and testing.
Yeah, I'm sure. I remember two things that affected the problem, and either one would have improved it, maybe enough to completely fix it. But you know, when you look at how it's made, you can see the photo interrupter and you can see the disc, so it's clear that there is an importance to the proximity between the two. You know, the disc has to go through the photo sensor such that it can obscure and unobscure the path. But what we saw when we took it in, when we took it apart, was two things. At part of its rotation, or at least part of its rotation, the disc was actually rubbing on one side of the photo interrupter. It was not in the center of the gap.
So it was, and it's probably that side because you can see some dust.
Yeah, you can see, right.
Yeah, so it was literally pushed up against here and rubbing, and there was some adjustment, and it was adjusted all the way it could go.
No, actually it was the other side, Gary, I'm sure. Okay. It looks like it, but and the reason I know that is because the fix we applied would stop it from rubbing that left-hand side in the photo there.
So is this the hole?
That's the screw holes, and then behind it is a slot that a locating pin went in. There was a good picture of the circuit board with the locating pin a little earlier. There, you can see that right next to the two screws are the locating pins in slots. And by
and the holes are oval, so you've got some room.
So you have some adjustment,
right?
But they were up against one stop.
Yeah, the board was all the way to the end of its travel in one direction, and the disc was still up against the photo interrupter. So we just filed those slots about a millimeter longer so that it would center the disc in a photo interrupter better. But centering the disc is, you know, when you have proximity of two things, there's three axes that can adjust the proximity of two things, X, Y, and Z, or J. And this was one of the two. The other axis would be if the center of the rotation of the knob were moved left or right, that go down to the center of the disc.
So the center is, you want things to be pretty much centered in each of these little holes where the light is going to shine from one side to the other.
Right.
And the disc itself wasn't deep enough into the slot.
And that was the second thing we fixed. It was not enough engagement. You know, the disc wasn't going deep enough in the slot. The photo path is not right at the edge of that horseshoe shaped. It's kind of down in there a little bit. And it looked like it was the disc was not deep enough in to really hit a good spot in the where the slots are in the disc. The disc needed to sit deeper into that horseshoe.
Yeah.
It looked like.
But it wasn't gonna.
Well,
no, not unless you unsolder it and put something in between.
Yeah. Well, and that's what we did. The things we thought about was thinning the board where it seats on the metal, frame. That would do it. But the easier way is to just raise the photo interrupter.
Whose genius idea was that?
Oh, was it yours? Ah, good. Good thinking.
Yeah.
Good thinking.
But I didn't know how you were going to do it.
So it's a surface mount device, which should not strike fear into the heart of anybody. So we removed it and cleaned up the board.
Wait a minute. It's striking fear into the heart of someone.
Oh, yeah. I'm not liking doing the surface mount soldering.
Well, there's some tricks. I can give you some tricks. You actually can prepare those to the point that components can be washed off a circuit board with hot water, literally. There is a bismuth alloy that I use. It's from a company called Chip Quick, and it looks like solder, but it's a lot stiffer. It'll break if you try to bend it, but it's got a low melting point, and when combined with solder, has a still lower melting point, 160 degrees. So if you just...
So hot breath will melt it.
Yeah. So you just act as though you're soldering the component on, even though it's already on, using this bismuth alloy instead of solder, and then the solder holding the part on has a very low melting point after that once they're mixed, and it will, you know, just a normal component. You heat it with the ordinary soldering iron, and it stays liquid for 30 seconds. You can literally go around a chip, meld it, and then pick up your tweezers and lift the chip up in there. It's pretty remarkable. But it can work, you know, without real high temperatures. You know, the problem with a printed circuit board in high temperatures is it can remove the copper trace right off the board. And when you do that, the repair just gets a lot more difficult.
Yeah. And you can destroy components, too.
Yeah, they have a solderability. There's actually a rating on how much temperature for how much time. So you can stay well below that easily, even on, you know, 100-pin chips.
So we wanted to raise this up, and I think in this picture it is raised.
Yeah, I think so.
So you unsoldered it, totally took it off.
Right.
And then put a...
Cleaned up the board.
Is that our shim?
Yeah, that was it. It's a piece of...
piece of ham radio now business card.
Right. It turned out to be 12 thousandths thick, which is about 3/10 of a millimeter.
Hang on. I think I got one right here. This...
Saved by the cardstock.
Yeah.
This was the shim.
Yeah.
And I thought you were going to leave it in there, and you pulled it out.
Yeah, we cut a thin strip off the end of it, narrower than the solder pattern for the photo interrupter, and then set it on the board and set the photo interrupter on top of it and just bridge, you know, 12 thousandths. You can make a solder bridge out of that. Mm-hmm. And so we just bridged. There were 6 connections on the photo interrupter, as I recall. Yeah, so it would be 2 for the LED and 2 for each photo transistor. So you're right, 2 apertures. Yeah. Not,
and you didn't want to leave it in there because it was paper. It would attract moisture.
Right, right. So it was thin enough. We just soldered the photo interrupter on and then slid it out.
Okay. The last thing, when we were going to make those, play with the the pots that the guy had talked about.
Right.
So we did that work, and we put things more or less back together to the point that he had described, where the whole thing was sitting out of the case of the radio through the hole where the tuning shaft would go.
Right.
And then we could turn the radio on and test, and it was working.
Mm-hmm.
And we got a heat gun and heated it up, and we got a freeze spray and cooled it down.
Got it really hot.
Yeah. Got it really hot, got it really cold.
Yeah.
It stopped working on cold, but we determined that the likelihood was that we had frosted over the
photo interrupter, right?
So it stopped seeing anything.
Yeah.
and it, as soon as we stopped the cold, it started working again.
Right.
So we think we're in pretty good shape. But the guy had described those pots.
Right.
So we had to.
Well, you got it. You can't leave them alone. The schematic was no help. Didn't even show them on the schematic. It was part of the square block that was the encoder.
Yeah, it was all black box, right?
Right, exactly right.
Something in, something out.
I don't think I got a picture that would show that.
That R3 and R5, those are the pots that he was talking about adjusting on the back.
Yeah,
those two there.
Mm-hmm.
Oh, that is them.
They're teeny.
Yeah,
that is them.
Yeah, that's them.
Okay.
Can you zoom into more of that? No. Yeah. Oh yeah.
Yeah.
Wow.
And they're 360 degree pots. They don't have a stop. You know, you can just turn them endlessly.
Yep. Just keep going. Yeah.
And we didn't know what they did, and we still don't know what their purpose was.
Right.
We tried looking things up, and nothing helped. So we adjusted them.
The
heck?
just because you could,
We did our best to spot exactly where they were. We did them one at a time. And what we discovered is with one of them, when we rotated it one direction, we didn't have to go very far before the radio quit working. The other direction, we could go a good 40 or 50 degrees before it stopped working. So it was right near the edge of the threshold. So we put it a little more into the working range by a little more. I'm saying, you know, between 5 and 10 degrees.
When you say radio wasn't working, you meant the dial didn't work, or
the dial stopped.
Yeah, and it was a real clear digital cliff. You know.
It either works or it doesn't.
Yep.
And the other potentiometer did exactly the same thing. There was a range over which it worked. Its position it was very, very close to the edge of that range. So we brought it into the range. 15%.
Yep. Because what the heck?
Yeah.
Because you could.
Yeah.
And then we took the radio back out and put it in the car. It was a nice, sunny, hot day.
Yeah, pretty hot. It was scattered clouds, so it didn't heat up as quick as it could have. But we had preheated the encoder.
We went to dinner.
Oh, that's right.
Let the car sit, went to dinner, came back, brought the thermometer out. The car was 113 degrees.
Yeah, and your opinion was that it was plenty hot enough in there to cause the radio to stop working if it was going to stop working.
And it was doing fine.
Yeah.
And it has continued to work fine.
Yeah, now that's been about 3 weeks or four.
With plenty of hot days.
Yeah.
And I've left it in the sun, didn't leave it covered.
Purposely.
Yeah, just to make sure. And everything was fine.
Yeah.
Do you usually cover those up when you're...
A
towel or something you put over it.
He's got a towel, and it's some for curious bystanders some for just why have it get the direct baking sun through the windshield.
I used to do that on my truck and the radios too, but I can't find that little towel anymore, so I don't do it.
They'll sell you one at, you know, Bed Bath and Walmart.
Yeah, I bet they will. So, hey, I wonder, what do you suppose if you had sent it back to ICOM? Think they'd just replace that whole unit?
Oh, yeah.
Just the whole thing? Yeah. The whole thing and the encoder and everything? Yeah.
So
hopefully they have maybe the faceplate.
One last little troubleshooting tip from me, and then Jeff, I think, has probably got a few more that you can toss in.
Sure.
And that's, there is this little chip, and we were kind of wondering, you know, what it did, and neither one of us could read it, and even with the magnifying glass and stuff, we couldn't really read it, so I took this picture.
I can read it.
Yeah. It blew up the picture, and we could tell what it was just fine. But you looked it up, and I don't think we learned anything.
It was an op amp,
okay.
Which will remove hysteresis, you know, from the optical.
Okay. And do you think the pots might have adjusted something within that?
Probably had a lot to do with the hysteresis and the gain. Yeah.
Okay. And just for the folks that are at the lowest level of our technical discussion, what's hysteresis?
It's where you find it in a circuit where a circuit, when you're, let's say you're turning a knob and the circuit flips one way, but then when you start turning the knob the other way, it doesn't flip back at the same exact point. You have to overshoot a little bit before it flips back. That's hysteresis. In some circuits, it's really desirable. Like in your cell phone, when it's doing a handover, you want a lot of hysteresis in the handover. So if you're going down the border between two cells, it's not switching back and forth, back and forth. But in other situations like this, you don't want hysteresis. If a person stops turning the knob and starts going the other way, you want it to switch at the same point it, you know, it switched last time.
I have a great physical example of hysteresis. Oh, good. I wish I had one with me. A slinky. You know how you hold a slinky and it will, let me give myself, hold a slinky and you jiggle it and it'll bounce back and forth. So you push it down and the bottom starts going down and down and down, and you pull up. It doesn't come right up. The bottom keeps going down for a while until it starts coming back up. That is hysteresis. You're welcome. Oops. Is it? Okay, maybe not.
Well, it's hysteresis with a few other things combined in it.
But it's the principle.
A lot more of Newton's laws, I think, that describes.
But it's the principle of hysteresis.
Yeah, same type of thing.
The idea is that you make a change one way and something starts changing.
Yeah.
And you make a change back and it doesn't immediately follow your change.
Right.
Okay.
Right.
Your description was better.
And I won't even read you what I found on Wikipedia about it, because that didn't help either.
Oh.
Let's see. Was there anything
else? It sounded like there was something else that you guys found, or did.
Once that was all done, and I started paying careful attention to things in the radio, I was talking to somebody, and I think I was trying to break a pileup or something. And I switched the radio into its narrow mode. And the guy said, your audio is terrible. And, you know, wide mode should sound like this. You know, just sound like a good audio. Narrow mode should sound like this. And, you cut through. You get rid of the lows and you get rid of a lot of the highs. And you have a narrow signal that should cut through better than a full fidelity audio. He said it sounded terrible. I never used narrow mode in that radio. So I went back to wide, and he said, yeah, it's better. But it's got some ringing to it. So, Jeff, we have... oops, there.
There you go. Oh.
Okay, you can pick up the microphone and speak into it. I think we'll hear you.
Okay, I'm tweaking down to the same frequency there.
Oh, you dial... 28.4.
Okay.
Yeah. All right, AC4ZO, fooling around a little bit. Hey, it sounds better than it did earlier.
It's still got the little bit of warble in it, but that's not the issue.
Yeah.
Yeah, there's the issue.
Oh, there's that pinging. What is that pinging?
Yep. Don't know, but it's interesting.
Yep. So
it's the slightest tap.
Initially, I thought that was something in the microphone, and okay, I'll turn your other mic back on there. I was thinking that was something in the microphone, because somebody was describing it's a little ringing to your signal. So I tried a different mic. I've got two other mics that'll work on their radio. Did the same thing. I tried that mic on another radio.
And it didn't do it.
Not
do it.
Sounded
fine. Yeah.
You know,
so more troubleshooting.
typical troubleshooting techniques.
Yep.
Which are wholesale replace. And so I tried a bunch of different settings in the radio. We have to swap places, Jeff, so I can play with that radio a little bit. I'm going to make you the technical director.
You did the full factory reset, right?
I've not done that yet.
Come on.
So come on in here.
I'm surprised Jeff didn't do it when he had it on the bench.
Say it again, David. Didn't hear that.
I'm surprised that when you had it on the bench, you didn't do a full factory reset. Oh. That's one of the things I'd have done. Just reset it. Gary can reprogram that stuff later. What's all on that radio is probably not a ton of stuff to reprogram anyways.
Okay, so Jeff, button number one, I think, is the radio. There we go. So take my mic down. I'll talk through the radio.
On which channel are you?
I'm channel two.
There we go. Okay, testing 1-2, 1-2, 1-2. And I'll get it over to this thing here where it says TBW, that's transmit bandwidth. And by the way, we're going into a dummy load, so we're not on the air. We're not violating FCC rules of any kind. So if I push it quickly, you can see it's a wide. I'm going to zoom this in a little bit more.
That's the wrong way.
There another zoom.
When you've got a 50-50 chance of doing something right, 9 times out of 10, you'll do it wrong.
Yeah.
So if you look at that, you'll see that it says wide, but if you hold it, it'll change to mid. So this is mid, and you can hear even more.
A lot more.
Go to narrow, and the guy said, oh, you sound terrible, and boy, can you hear it ring.
Yeah, and there's some warble, too.
The warble is something in our system. Something in our system.
Oh, you get feedback.
I'm not sure why it's happening, but it's not really what's in the radio. And then we'll go back to wide, which doesn't sound too bad, but shouldn't be doing that. And if I go to other modes, AM, FM, everything sounds normal. It's only inside band that you hear it. So, that's the next problem to figure out. So we don't know what we're going to do. In operating this this way in with the radio in wide, no one's really complaining about it. Everybody's pretty happy with what it sounds like. So I'll just keep on doing that.
Well, David, what's your opinion? I'm still hearing some ringing on wide. It's not near as pronounced.
Yeah, I hear it too. Even across the country here, it's coming through on my single earbud.
Yeah. Oh, you're copying me on 10 meters all the way
on
over
10 meters. Yeah, I got you all the way here. You're about 5'7".
Must be a double hop of E.
That's a good dummy load.
Yeah.
Well, I guess it'd be a very poor dummy load.
So I'm thinking. Oh, give me that little black pad there. Now I can switch my own shots. There you go. That's you. There we go. So I'm thinking that from now on, I'm going to do ham radio now this way. Screw the Heil mics.
There you go. That'll really drive the subscription rate up.
Jeff likes hams doing ham stuff. And you don't get any more ham doing ham stuff than doing it on a ham.
The only problem is when you do that, Gary, if you do it that way, people are going to spend all the show just trying to tune the dial just a little bit to actually catch you, because you're just a little off.
I'm fading. Wait,
exactly. Yep, there you go.
I've got a helium here. Let me try to get right back down.
And then you say, wait, oh no, we're doing the Darth Vader thing. Luke, I am your father. I'm your father, Luke. Okay.
That's the Barry White. You've got that down.
All right. You ready to go back to the proper mic?
Okay.
Here we go.
All right.
That mic sounds pretty good there, Gary.
I can do the whole show from over here using this.
Your little switcher.
There's the button. Yeah. Using this little switcher pad. Let's see if I can guess which way is wide. Nope.
Even after just doing it.
Pretty cool. Oh, nice quiet chair too. So we talked about some troubleshooting techniques.
Yeah.
Do you have any other general, when you're approaching something?
Will that radio do FM as well and AM?
Yes.
Try the other modes? Is it doing the other modes?
Well, yeah. No.
It doesn't do it, right?
Yeah. I'm not sure I can talk you into the mode button over there. but I'll try to find the mode over here.
And there's that factory reset.
What mode do you want?
I don't know what the implications on what you lose that's programmed in the radio.
Everything. But I got to get
I guess the question is like how much is everything? This
radio is not highly programmable, but there is an RT Systems software for it, or maybe even Chirp. Yeah. I just got to get a cable.
AM?
So we want FM. Let's go to FM. We'll try AM in a bit. We're not in the FM band, but again, we are on a dummy load, so it's not going to be a big deal. FM. Test. Have we faded up there? Okay. Whoa, that didn't sound very good. Turn this mic off here.
That may be where our hum is coming from, but in any case...
Well, I mean, if you key the mic and you bang on it, it's going to make the noise.
Right.
Well, you're getting a ticking, but that's ticking you should be getting.
Yeah.
No right. Pain. Exactly.
It's not a sustained ringy.
That's what our jammer on our weekly net does.
Oh, jeez.
It goes like this.
Yeah, I think sometimes.
Okay, let's try AM.
It still don't sound great.
Okay.
Oh, there you go.
This may be the source of our hum and sideband.
Yeah.
Not sure where this is coming from. I hope my power supply isn't going bad.
All right, so that was a dumb idea. Try something else.
Okay.
That's pretty cool.
Yeah, you got to switch the modes. There you go.
Alrighty.
All right.
So, switching back to the big microphone.
So, general troubleshooting technique. You approached something that's not working the way it ought to?
Well, you know, there actually are documented techniques for troubleshooting, and I've got a class at work that I teach, and that's the very first section in the class. It's a hardware-centric class, and the steps it goes through are simple. The first is to collect information, and it's surprising how much information can get overlooked when you're looking for a problem. The tidbit you had in this particular example that was really helpful is that right before it fails completely, as things are heating up and things are really falling apart, you can push the knob one way and make it work a while longer. That's valuable information, but that's rare information. Typically, what you'd be looking for are lights that are on that shouldn't be, lights that should be on that are not on, little things in the display.
Is it plugged in?
Well, that sort of thing, yeah. Yeah, and once you collect the information, then you can sort out what's working and what's not working. For instance, your microphone issue right here is not a problem in other modes. It's just a single sideband mode. So that pretty much rules out the microphone itself because it operates exactly the same way regardless of the mode that the transmitter is operating in.
Yeah, plus I had swapped
out. You tried it on another rig, so you isolated that out as well.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And then you brought another mic from another rig and put it on there again, troubleshooting, right?
Yep, exactly.
Yep. So another
not doing
mic
my job.
On here.
But Jeff's not doing his job. I don't know. Same number pad over there. We'll do the switching.
I just spent 3 minutes since you told me what number. and then the next thing is, and it doesn't apply so much to the radio, but with other things, where the problem isn't can help you. You know, as much as where the problem is, like if you have one radio in your car that's acting up and all the rest of the radios work, you wouldn't expect a battery problem, for instance. One of the examples I use is that the company I work for makes machines that dispense cutting tools in machine shops. And typically a large shop, say 100,000 square foot shop would have maybe half a dozen of these machines sprinkled around the plant, and they're controlled by a computer, just a Windows PC in there. And an example I use is if one of those machines reports a high temperature alarm in the PC, you might suspect maybe a fan filter clogged up or a fan has failed. But if all six of them report a high temperature alarm within 5 minutes of each other, it's not very likely that they all had a fan fail at the same time. It's a completely different thing. So looking at where the problem, you know, at what is still working compared to what's not, can be really valuable in helping you narrow down a problem.
Something that some people may have noticed about the troubleshooting that we did here is that there were no scopes and no meters involved. We didn't measure anything.
No.
And some of the folks that were showing things on YouTube and other things related to this, they had scopes on their encoders and they were showing the rise and fall times and stuff. None of that made any sense to go into at this point.
No, and it we could have. I mean, point. There was a scope right there on the bench that that we could have used, 14-inch screen.
Yeah.
But we didn't, you know.
So it wasn't
I mean, that's appropriate when it's necessary.
It wasn't a case of that being the hammer and this being the nail.
There wouldn't have been a whole lot of value in you putting that thing on. I mean, unless you wanted to see is the encoder just not getting the data through. But it seemed pretty obvious that it did. It was just, it was, again, more of a mechanical problem.
Yeah, yeah. Yeah, and just looking at it, you know, you could see that it's a very mechanical device.
Yeah. And I'm not saying that the tools, the measurement devices are never the first thing to use. In this case, they weren't.
No, and unless we just wanted to learn more about how that encoder works, we probably could have figured out what those pots did by using some test gear. Mm-hmm. But
we were hungry.
But we didn't. Is that what it was? It was getting on dinner time. That's right. I knew we were trying to hurry it for some reason. I couldn't remember why.
And it worked at that point, right? Because you could show it. This it worked, and that if it didn't work, maybe you would have gone a little further.
Yeah.
Down that road.
And we could make it stop working by tweaking the pots. You know.
Our curiosity pretty much ended at taking a picture of it and figuring out what the number was and seeing what the internet said about that part.
Yeah,
I've actually done exactly what you did before. I had a problem reading something. It's getting worse and worse every day. And I did exactly. I took a picture. I took it into the computer on the PC and I blew it up. Wow, there's the numbers. I can read it great now.
A lot of times you can just do it right on the phone. You can biggerize it. see it.
One thing that hams, especially the more technically oriented hams, complain about these days is nobody fixes anything. Fix it. Fix it. Nobody fixes anything. They just replace circuit boards, major component assemblies, because it's generally cheaper, way faster.
Faster. There was a time when things were point-to-point wire with terminal strips and those oil-filled capacitors. There was no printed circuit board, maybe in a tuner, but certainly not in the rest. You know, the rest of the TV was about the only thing we worked on back then. And early ham radio, same thing, you know, point-to-point wiring and stuff. Circuit boards came along later. And I think a lot of people, you know, replace components. There's not a lot of people that really understand the electronics to that depth, you know, that they could find the component.
Which is why I went to you.
Right.
Yeah.
Well, I think there's also, you know, probably 40, 50 years ago, the radios were built more, it was a more conducive to opening it up and actually pulling something out, getting into that mobile rig that you've got. You know, there's probably a couple stacked circuit boards, and if you had to get in a layer or two below, then you're really taking that thing apart.
Yeah, and getting into it, into the panel, turn things off, and the panel comes off easy.
Yeah,
and then getting into it,
that's just a couple screws.
Take a couple screws, it comes apart. The little springs fly away and you can never find them.
There were two of them.
That's what duct tape's for.
Only one went to the floor.
And so it was not hard to get it apart, and then getting and there were like two layers and everything was obvious for
in the head unit. But if the problem ended up being in the there, it'd have been a different story.
Yep. Maybe. Although they don't tell you never to open it up because there's some user-adjustable things in there.
Yeah.
Well, I'm thinking the 706 Mark IIG, you could change filters and things. Yeah. Maybe in here there isn't anything that they want you to do.
Well, not that they want you to do, but depending on who the user is, you know, anything can have user-serviceable parts.
Sure. even if it says there are no user serviceable parts.
Yeah. Yes, and breaking this tape will void the warranty.
Which you should do, like, right when you get it. Well, actually, no.
Yeah, so you quit worrying about it, right?
Yeah, exactly. Maybe when the warranty expires.
Well, then you worry about when it's going to break, and now you can't send it back in warranty.
Yeah. So what are you going to do?
Well, I mean, if you're being conservative, you wait until the warranty expires, then cut the little piece of tape, and off you go.
So once again, all of the mailing list advice was send it back to ICOM, or at the very least, order the part. So it would have been $60-$70 or so.
Well, in their defense.
So for the first problem, right, but for the second problem, has anybody else reported or experienced that?
Oh, yes.
Oh, okay. So this is a common problem, too. Okay.
Yeah, although I haven't narrowed it down to anyone's. They'll first of all, ringing is a common problem. Uh-huh. Everyone says you can only operate this radio in the wide bandwidth mode. That medium and narrow are terrible. As it so happens, all of those are very adjustable. Just because the can I remember which way to do this? I keep pushing the photo button. Yep.
There you go.
Wrong. Okay. So just because there's, you know, there's the.
Because it has the mode doesn't mean it's usable.
Yeah. Well, here's where you can set what the low and high end of the various bandwidths are. Mm-hmm. So in that narrow mode, the low end is currently set at 500 hertz. So you can see it says low and 500 over here. Mm-hmm. And then the high end is at 2800. And if I were to, that's as narrow as I can make it. 500 is the highest low frequency, and you can, so I could set it so that when it says it's narrow, it's actually the widest there is. You know, this is fully adjustable.
Yeah.
But these are all useless. Something that this sort of tells me is that, that's a design problem. It's not a specific problem with this radio. And one of the steps in further troubleshooting is going to be to borrow another whole 7,000. Friend of mine has got a spare.
See if it does the same thing.
Yeah. I borrowed his control head and put it on, and nothing changed.
Got it.
And I listened to his other 7,000 in his car. I didn't think I was hearing that, but I didn't have all the parameters adjusted the way I need to really fine tune it. So I'm going to just borrow the whole one, bring it up here in the shack.
See what it does.
See why this power supply seems to be humming like crazy.
Yeah.
So there's some more troubleshooting. Yeah. We were hearing a little ripple on the sideband. I switched to FM and AM and bzzz.
Yeah.
What?
Yeah.
Oops. Why? Well, where's that coming from? Troubleshoot somewhere, that, Jeffy.
Well, somewhere in your studio, right?
And that you actually can use a meter to troubleshoot. Set it for AC volts and put it across the DC line and see how much ripple there is.
A scope would be better, but voltmeter would work.
Yeah. Scope would be better. I can pop it over here.
Yeah.
So, you know, I asked about resetting it because, you know, my troubleshooting experience mostly is from the PC IT world. I've been doing that for 20 years. And
turn it off.
Well, you know, so restart it is a good thing, but anything that has parameters that an end user can screw up, you know, the first thing you always want them to do is, okay, well, take it back to factory. And if it doesn't work in factory, then there's something wrong with it. If it does work in factory, there's something wrong with you. You know, and so
that's good.
Eliminate the adjustments, because a lot of times people get in there and they're, oh, I'm going to play with this, I'm going to play with that, I'm going to play with the other thing, and I don't remember to set them back. So
the problem is between the keyboard and the chair.
Yeah, oh, absolutely. 90% of the time, that's where the problem exists. Somewhere I have a T-shirt that says that.
Yep. So, something that hams like to do when there's any trouble with anything, is speculate endlessly.
Oh, yeah.
And the less information they have, the more they'll speculate. Is that useful?
Well, it's entertaining.
It might be. You never know.
I don't know. When that's going on, that kind of speculation going on, A lot of people will just discount the whoever is speaking, but
the less you know, the less your background is. If you're the guy asking for help, and you don't have a background in depth, all that speculation is going to send you to.
And even if you do, well, you'll go on a lot of wild goose chases, but one of them could lead you to gold. But even a knowledgeable person, when he's listening to speculation from a less knowledgeable person, what if they stumble on something that something can click? Oh, he mentioned this, but, maybe not exactly that, but could be related. Mm-hmm. So I think it's valuable.
Yeah. Okay.
If it's a guy that works on the bench next to you that's speculating, Jeff, you might take it with more value than if it's the guy that's mopping the floor when you guys all go home. Right.
Right.
Now, but if he speculates, maybe it's because I dropped it, then there's another parameter of information you didn't have before.
Yeah.
So I'll know more once I test another one of these radios. But there's enough people out there that say that this is a thing, not describing exactly like me. Mm-hmm. That I'm thinking, it may be a design issue. But
did it work before, Gary?
Well, see, then that's the question. I had just about never gone into that narrow mode.
Oh, okay.
So you can't
rule that out.
Right. So then what I did was I took a receiver, Kenwood THF6 Handy Talkie, which hears sideband on HF, out to the car, put on headphones, listened to myself, and listened to in narrow, and I could hear what the guy was talking about. Oh yeah, it sounded, what you guys just heard sounded terrible. And then it's this ping, ping, ping. What the heck? Did that happen before? Did that happen because we had the control panel open? Probably not, but
Well, other people are reporting it, right?
Yeah. But I hadn't noticed it before. And then, this one guy says, I'm hearing some ringing. And I think I was probably in the medium mode because I thought, I accidentally left it there. Most of the time I've been operating in wide. So, yeah, I can't tell you whether it had ever been a problem before or not.
Well, I've been speculating for 20 minutes on what the problem actually is.
I missed all of that.
So what do you think?
In my head. Oh. Well, yeah.
Oh, in your head.
Yeah. And the tidbit here is that other people say you can't use it in that mode. It suggests that a lot of people are having this exact problem. And the last few weeks, I've actually been doing circuit board design at work. And the lots of circuitry in a real small space. The problem with printed circuit boards is distributed capacitance between all those thin traces that are a few thousandths of an inch away from each other across the board, and that it is probably some sort of feedback caused by stray capacitance between the LANs running parallel to each other around the board. If that's the case, all models will do it, and it can't be repaired. The board would need to be redesigned with the LANs away from each other or something between them to break up that capacitance. Yeah. So.
Is that something of an issue of people learning computers too much and not physics? In this, as they start to design these things,
well,
they can lay them out on a computer real easy.
Yeah,
but the computer isn't taking those factors into consideration.
Yeah, and I don't know that a human would either. I mean, a lot of us don't use. There are routers built into printed circuit design software, but a lot of people don't use. That what the router does is it makes the tracks all go between each other to get from point A to point B. Good routers are expensive. Cheap routers are not very effective. So a lot of people do their own routing manually, and I do that.
But they're not learning RF. And this capacitance, you have to get up into at least low RF before it starts to have an effect.
Yeah.
So they're not learning anything about RF.
And it's RF related because it only does it in certain RF modes.
Yeah. Well, okay, some more data points. I can adjust the power level up and down, no change. I can go from 160 meters to 2 meters to 70 centimeters, no change.
So it's not in the PA part.
Right, so at a low level somewhere.
Yeah.
Where the PA power and frequency don't affect it.
Right.
Which means that it's going to be a pretty low level signal.
Yep.
That's still, if that's what's happening, so I'm thinking with even less knowledge to go on that maybe there is something in in the processing. It's a DSP-based, I think DSP-based filtering for the transmit bandwidth.
Yeah.
And maybe they accidentally left some little feedback path in there.
Yeah.
In the software design.
Yep, almost for
total
sure.
Total guess.
It can't be in the mic audio circuit, or it would do it in all modes.
Yeah. Other people have said that there's a mic jack on the back. You know, try the mic back there. I did that. No change.
And does
no
it do difference. It there? Does it yeah. does it do it there too?
Yep, no problem. No change.
All right. So then when you get, so really when you get the other radio and you try that out and it does it.
Yeah. So again, as a troubleshooting technique, wholesale swap and replace.
Yeah.
Is,
well, or just
that's
take,
a
or
quick
you take,
way.
Yeah. Well, you take a similar unit and see, does it do it too? And well, then I'm going to be back to, if it doesn't do it, then I'm going to be back to do the factory reset.
Yeah. And I'm, by wholesale, I mean absolutely everything, but I mean piece by piece.
Yeah. The control head, the body.
Yeah. If your goal is to really find out where the problem is and fix it at its source, that's one way to isolate it.
Yeah.
If your goal is to get the thing working again and money is not as much of an issue as time, then you swap until it works again and you throw away the last part and you're done.
Right.
Yeah, but I think what you're going to find is there is no part you can swap to make it work.
Right.
Well, and these are
said.
Yeah, these are not micro components; they're macro components, and you're going to have like three. Right. You're going to have the mic. You're going to have the head unit. You're going to have the body.
Right.
And maybe you got lucky and change out the cable, but I don't see where that's going to help at all.
Yeah.
But there's like three, four pieces, and then that's it.
Yeah. So anything else? That
concerning troubleshooting?
Yeah.
No.
Well, there's a lot of things, but
it's that troubleshooting is a skill that's very difficult to teach. People that are good at troubleshooting just seem to be born with the ability to separate the wheat from the chaff.
You're here.
Well, okay, there's something that's occurred to me is where do you get yourself in trouble?
You can it's easy to fixate on something that is not the problem. We call it a wild goose chase, Yeah.
Something of a result of that speculation. You have isolated the problem in your mind to the wrong thing, and now you're going to beat on that until it fixes it.
Yeah, a preconceived notion can be really costly and never lead, to the actual problem. That's really tough. The other thing is, Most troubleshooting, like David has I got, you're involved in a help desk of some sort, I think.
I had a number of years ago. Did a lot of that. Yeah.
So where and where I work, we have a tech support. It's got a dozen or so technicians that really struggle, especially with hardware problems. And the problem is twofold. One, they will the input they get is not good. And they run with bad input.
They're talking
to a customer and said, when you tried A, is the result you got B? And the customer says, yeah. And they'll take that as gospel. Well, he tried A and he got B. When, that's not a very convincing answer. So how much time, you're going to have to ask the question a different way or find a way to verify it for yourself, And the other thing is... I forgot what the other thing was.
I spent a lot of years doing PC troubleshooting. That's where my experience is, PC and networks. And as Jeff said, it's hard to teach somebody else good troubleshooting skills. And very often I would, so I started on a help desk and I ended up like third level support. So, the help desk would give it to a desk side. And then eventually if they could figure it out, it would get to me. Right. And the biggest challenge is people that were in that middle level, as Jeff said, would get fixated on this part is bad. And you go look at it and I'm like, okay, well, have you started with the basic things? One of my overarching troubleshooting, rules is start with the little stuff first. Did you change the cable? Cable's cheap. Cables are easy. Cables are everywhere. You can't just replace the whole CPU or the memory or the other stuff, but change out the cable. Wow, that fixed it. Awesome. You fixed it for $2. But people will get stuck in the memory's bad or the CPU's bad or this is bad or that is bad. Well, have you tried other things? No, no, I'm convinced that's it. Okay, we'll step back and see what else it could be. And, you know, I learned over time those people that didn't have that ability to, you know, oh, I think it's this and try other things. You have to get them out of the troubleshooting. When you have a problem, give it to somebody else. Let them fix it. Yeah. And you go on with the other things. Because some people, like you said, some people are good software. Some people are good hardware. Some people aren't good neither.
Yeah. And I remember what the other thing is that I was thinking about. And it's it is where a troubleshooter has an undue amount of faith in themselves and too little yeah. faith in the customer. There are, you will hear a person on a help desk tell a customer 1,000 times, you don't understand, you don't understand, you don't understand. Yeah. When it could be that client is trying to tell the help desk guy something that will lead him to the problem, but he's a unidirectional communicator. He can't receive, you know, when I hear it all the time, you know, in tech support, somebody will call in and the tech support person will argue with them that can't possibly be what you're seeing instead of saying to himself, what is he seeing that's making him think this?
Mm-hmm.
And to be an effective troubleshooter, you know, it's as psychological as, you know, as it is technical.
All right. Mm-hmm. But when you are the client, your
experience is all in who you get.
So you're the troubleshooter and the client and everything else. Now you're fixing your own radio.
So
you're the client. You're the technician. Where can you lead yourself astray? Besides everywhere.
Well, test equipment that you're not clear about, like a meter that loads a circuit, a high impedance circuit. With a high impedance circuit, it's a risk. With a low impedance circuit, it's not a risk. But with experience, you learn those sorts of things. So I would say just misuse of test equipment, common mode problems like the hum that three of us are assuming is coming from a power supply, but may or may not be. Because we haven't looked yet, you know. Well,
it's obviously the power supply because that's where hum comes from.
Well, that's fine. You could prove that in 30 seconds. Go get a battery and turn the power supply off and plug the radio into a battery, and then you know.
Yeah, that's a good way.
Yeah. All right. I think we've made an interesting show out of that.
Yeah.
I wanted to take a couple minutes and talk about your weekend, David.
Yeah. So we had a fun and exciting weekend. So, this was our once a year we get together and we play with the big kids, as I like to say, California National Guard, typically California Highway Patrol, Los Angeles Police Department, Los Angeles Fire Department. And they play in some way or the other. Sometimes you get more participation. Sometimes you get less. The National Guard has to drill every year. And so they're almost always there. And it's the other departments come or not. I typically get to work at kind of a remote station. But the scenario that we had was a plane crash next to a golf course. And, you know, I actually had about 20 of my Boy Scouts go out and they moulanged them up and put them in ambulances, everything. And I didn't get to play in that part. I was at the what they call the TOC, the Technical Operations Center. And so I got to see all of the captains and all of the leaders of these teams, you know, walk through the tabletop exercise. Okay, this happened, and what do you do? And then that happened, and what do you do? And then eventually, once they mobilized everyone, because they did mobilize a bunch of National Guard folks and some fire department folks, I got to take them up to the top of the hill at a secret unidentified location. And then we did some comms checks, and it was fun. And it took a couple hours. Then we got to go home. And then I did a Boy Scout thing for a bunch of hours, and all this happened in about a 9,500 degree day. And I got home about 8 o'clock or maybe 7:30. And I thought it'd be cool to jump in the pool, and the pool was about 90 degrees. So it wasn't as refreshing. And I just wanted to go to bed. And about the time I laid down on the pillow, my cell phone went off, and unbeknownst to me, there was a fire at a power switching station in Northridge. It's probably about 10 miles from me as the crow flies. And it caused a major power outage. And actually, initially it was a small power outage, but to get in there to fight the fire, I think they said it was 200 gallons of mineral oil, which is what they used to fill the transformers. They had to de-energize that station, and then they lost power to about 150 or 175,000 people in the San Fernando Valley, including five of the hospitals we support, the Aries group that I work with. So I got a phone call from our DEC saying, hey, he's at one of the hospitals and it's on internal emergency. They have no power. They have no air conditioning. Backup generators are doing some things, but they're closed to business. And we needed to start up a net, and we needed to find out the status of all the other hospitals in the valley and see about an activation. So I got to activate. And honestly, this is the first real activation I've had with Aries. So out here in the studio, not sit in this direction, but sit in the other direction, you can see my go box over my shoulder. On the phone and on the radio, and I don't know, we had about 12 or 13 other people know enough to get on the radio and check in. All of the folks on our team that have access to paging lists we have didn't have power or weren't available to operate it, and I'm not of the rank or stature to have access to that. So all I could do were make phone calls to the folks that I know. And so, you know, we established the status of a bunch of the hospitals. Of the six I talked to, I think four of them were all in that dark zone on generators, but basically closed to business for emergency traffic, primarily because the CAT scan units all require more power and you know, need the grid. And you know, if you have a very you have a bad car accident or something else, they need to be able to put you in that to see what's really wrong, internal injuries and so on and so forth. So ran the net for, I don't know, I think an hour and a half or so. I passed it over to somebody else, and they told me to go to bed because I would be second shift at one of the hospitals. Never did get the call in the middle of the night. Most of the hospitals came back online by about 5 a.m. The worst of the affected Northridge Hospital, I think they said it came back up about 1:30 or 2 o'clock in the afternoon on Sunday. So some excitement.
Was there a communications outage along with a power outage at the hospitals?
Oh, well, the whole valley lost telephone. And most of the cell sites were not operational. All my contacts at the cell site, the phone call that I got through, you know, he basically finally went out on the roof somewhere and was able to get in. But then most of the rest of the time when he was trying cell phones later on, wasn't able to get out. You know, all the cell sites have batteries, but over time, you know, they only will keep the cell sites online for so long.
Yeah. You don't have generators that kick in?
In the hospital locally, they do. And so most of the hospitals had internals. Not a lot of that cell sites don't. You know, the cell sites are on, you know, power poles and plugged in. And some of them will have the little vault boxes, but usually the vault boxes just have, you know, these big 100, 185 amp hour batteries. But, you know, unless they're checked and maintained all the time, you never know if they're good to go.
He's in Los Angeles, Jeff. I'm used to cell sites having a big block building and a great big Generac sitting next to, you know, half the size of my house. And but you got these little femto cell things.
That's the thing. Most of the cell phone sites you see here, they're on a power pole or on the top of a 7-Eleven building, and you know, a whole bunch of sector antennas pointing out here and there. But there's not a lot of infrastructure where the local installations are, because very rarely do we lose power. Yeah. Where you guys are, you know, you got a storm coming through, you probably expect to lose power.
Yeah. What was the weather during that power outage?
It was hot. It was hot. In fact, one of, so we were in a heat wave. I think even at night it was in the 90s. I know one of the hospitals, Northridge, where my DEC was, I think they said they went to Home Depot and bought 120 box fans. and, you know, just kind of put them all throughout the hospital on the generator power they had just to move the air around.
Yeah, that's no weather to be out of air conditioning in.
Yeah, it's tough. And they did have to transport patients out to some of the fringe hospitals that were still on the grid and still powered.
So the questions I always ask when something like that happens is, what kind of real traffic did you pass? Because so much of our activity is our own logistics of getting our hams from one place to another and directions and stuff, and little for the served agency. So it sounds like you might have had a chance to really tell them something.
Well, actually, so for the most part, it was mostly our logistics. I spent more time trying to get through to the hospitals that I could get through to establish, okay, you're in the dark zone. Are your phones working? And some of them did, and you could get into like some of the mains, but you couldn't get into the other areas. Just establishing, hey, are you up and running? And we have a system called ReadyNet. That's what the hospitals use to say they're up or they're down, and how many beds they have available, so the ambulance services know that they can bring traffic to the hospital. So trying to get a hold of the hospitals to figure out what's your ReadyNet status. So we can report back that they could bring patients there. And then if they weren't up and running, did they need additional assistance? And most everybody didn't. The one hospital did. Most of their hospitals said, you know, basically they just shut down operations and they were, you know, maintaining, you know, the internal patients as best they could, but they didn't need additional communication helps because they didn't expect that they would have any major, you know, major casualty or influx of patients.
So I was getting a little lost as you were describing who you were and were not able to communicate with. Did hams deploy to these hospitals?
A couple of them did. The Northridge Hospital primarily, and most of the other hospitals indicated that at that time they didn't need deployment. Okay. So I didn't deploy any further than here.
And you were able to talk to them how?
Some of them, you know, some of the main phone lines still will get through, and even though some of the internal systems weren't. So, you know, basically I have a list of ERs and main contact numbers. So you dial them until you got through, or you figured out that you got a busy signal or a signal that the call couldn't go through, and then you went on to the next one.
Are these hospitals that have permanent stations and staff that are now licensed to operate them?
Almost all the hospitals that we work with have some kind of ham station there, but it kind of varies. And more of the internal employees are getting licensed so that they can help out in disaster. But most of the time when you have an issue like that, those people are either they're not there because it's not enough people, or they have some other more important job to do than to sit and run and talk to a radio. And that's why we deploy if we're needed to deploy.
So is this one of those situations where you could look at what you were doing and see a gap between what you wish you were able to be doing?
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Yeah, I mean, you know, if I hadn't had to get up at 5 a.m. and work all day, mostly all in the hot sun, I probably would have deployed out earlier. And I know from the folks that were at the hospital that they did want us deployed at. You know, I knew he'd be okay till 3 or 4 in the morning and then would need a replacement. So that was the point where, you know, I felt like a little kid. They sent me in my room and told me to go to bed. but they knew that I'd be able to get up and go and handle whatever was going on there. And somebody else took over the net.
All right. Wow. That's quite a deployment.
Yep. Yeah. And I sat here thinking to myself, well, I have about half a page of notes on, stuff that in that case I'm mostly ready and I could probably be in my truck and out on the road in 15 or 20 minutes. But, I got a list of things. I could probably cut that in half now.
And you were telling me in email that, media was not high on your list of priorities, recording the nets.
When I got up to go to bed, I turned around and I looked at my ham radio now station and thought, crap, I could have turned on the recorder and the webcam and captured all that. And next time I will. But I was really, I mean, I spun the net up. I ran the net for a long time, and it was, you know, it's, it really causes you to focus. And I had my two little hams out here, and, had a logger, and I had somebody trying to get through the hospitals, and they were pretty helpful too, even though they didn't quite always understand what they needed to find out from the hospital. I spun them up. I think after I did two of them, they were able to kind of take over and at least get me to the person that I needed to talk to figure out what the status was when we got through.
Yeah. Well, my takeaway is always that the media is a full-time job. It shouldn't be a part-time job of the guy who's doing everything else. It's the PIO's job, and you need one, and you need one to be there and doing stuff all the time.
That's a challenge we have. I do not believe at this time that in our section, Northwest section of LA, that we have an official PIO. I really don't. And it's come up before. I don't know who that person is. I don't know who I'd refer people to. And if I was deployed and some, you know, TV or radio news person came up and shoved the mic in my face, and I'm supposed to refer them to the PIO, and I would do that. And then they'd ask me who it was, and I'd have to kind of shrug my shoulders and say, I don't know. I have no idea who it is.
So
it doesn't help them.
No, it doesn't. Not at all.
Yeah. Well, you've also got to be a little careful in a situation like that. If you're deployed somewhere and the news media is talking to you, they shouldn't be talking to you.
Yeah, well, exactly. And that's, you know, we train the folks, and I know, you know, if they come up and talk to you, tell them, you know, thank you, I've got a job to do, and you should go talk to the PIO. You know, most of the hospitals, if we deploy at a hospital, the hospital has a, you know, internal PIO, and I would just send them to that person. Yeah. It wouldn't be the Aries person. It would be the one representing the hospital.
And how do we get to the point where that person, the hospital's publicity guy, makes sure that they all point to the hams and say, and those guys are doing a great job because the rest of our communications are out?
Yeah, I don't know. We're going to keep working on that.
We're going to
keep working on that. You know, when we did do some good relationship building in this deployment, I know, at that hospital. And I know from a lot of the drilling we do in most of the hospitals where we show up and we do our thing, we definitely build bonds there with, you know, management, and, you know, hopefully the PIO sees it. I have a feeling that if I was a PIO of a hospital and I was being interviewed by the news, the last thing on my list, maybe not the last thing, but one of the really low things on my list would be, oh yeah, and the amateur radio guys were awesome. Right. Now, it's one thing if everything was down and they needed, you know, plasma or people or supplies that they didn't have, or, you know, to move out in the parking lot and they needed the decom trucks or the mobile operating studio trucks, and they couldn't get it any other way than having us call them in, then maybe they would bring us up. But I think ordinarily, I don't think that that's something they think about. They see us, but
communication, it may be the end all for us, but it's a very minor part of what they have to deal with.
Absolutely.
If there is no communications, it's a complication for them. It's not a showstopper.
I'm not sure I agree with that.
There have been some deployments about the time I joined, and I didn't participate in this. They had a hospital on a bright, sunny, wonderful day during the week, and AT&T was digging a ditch in front of the hospital, and they cut through the trunk line and just to completely destroy the entire phone system in the building and out of the building. And I know a number of hams deployed to the hospital, throughout the hospital, with HTs and other radios to relay from the ER to the pharmacy to the X-ray room, you know, to the CAT scan room, to the operation center, to just pass the traffic around so there weren't people having to do sneaker net. And in those cases, could they have done it? Sure, they could have done it. But having the hams there, you know, just improved the situation, and having people that in theory are, you know, great communicators and know what to say and not to say and how to get the message across, does make it easier in a bad situation.
In theory.
Yeah, I agree.
In theory.
Okay, one last thing. On our Facebook group, somebody asked a really good question recently. Remember which one that was? That you answered, and a few other people chimed in.
You, David, or you?
David, yeah. You don't read our Facebook group, Jeff.
I do remember answering.
You answer a bunch.
Oh yeah, it's like, yeah, it's the who and the how and the when to deploy, and what do you do about your boss if your boss is friendly or not? Or
yeah, as I got, the crux of the question was, how do you balance work and deployment, which is, you know, which is more important, and how do you convince the boss you should go?
Yeah.
So how? I mean, maybe you can't.
You know, it's that's a hard question. You know, I probably don't align myself with most of the other people in there. And I know from reading through the answers to the question, I definitely didn't. You know, family first always, right? In Aries and pretty much everywhere else. And everybody agrees to that. Most of the other people thought work was second. Work is like way down on my list. I got my wife and my kid. I got my wife. That's one. The kids are number two. The cats are probably three or four. My scout troop and that, the community, and my work comes further down the list. Now, my role at work is continuity, business continuity. And so if there's a work failure, then yeah, I'll be there from them. But if there's a community-wide failure, an earthquake or whatever, I've been pretty clear with my management that we can cut payroll checks for TV and movies later on. But in the event of a big earthquake, the community needs the service that I can provide more than the company does. And quite honestly, there was a little bit of a questioning look in their eyes. And I said, and quite honestly, you should be going home too and dealing with your stuff at home too and making sure your family's okay too. And that'll be the first thing I do. And after that's done, then I'm going to go figure out if I need to deploy, where I'm going to deploy, and so on and so forth. Now, I am a little more community service minded than a lot of other people. And I know there's probably folks there and maybe small business owners or what have you, or have more responsible roles in a company that would say, oh my gosh, I have to go to my business and make sure that's all fine. And you know, if that's your deal, that's your deal, and it's all good. But yeah, if there's a disaster, I'm not rushing off to work.
Yeah.
And I won't get paid, and that's okay.
This is one of those things where there is no one single answer, because the situations are going to be different for everybody.
Yeah, and some businesses can tolerate a person's absence more than other businesses. And some businesses, my last job, you know, if I was in front of a classroom, I probably couldn't go for an incident in the western part of the state. But if I wasn't in front of the classroom, if I was writing courseware, it was really no problem to get off. Yeah. Where I am now, that company wouldn't tolerate it hardly at all.
Yep. It's it depends on where the disaster is. If it's all around you, you know, David is saying your boss ought to be going home too.
If it affects the business, either geographically or otherwise, it's a lot easier to probably react.
Where I was working and the companies I've been working for, if I was scheduled to work with a client and the disaster didn't take us down, then they kind of needed me to be there. Mm-hmm. When I was freelancing, like I wanted desperately to go to Hurricane Katrina, and I was freelancing at the time. I didn't have a boss to report to, but I had a full week of work lined up at three different clients, and to tell all of them, sorry, find someone else, was not going to fly. So I didn't get to go to Katrina.
Yeah. And you had to eat too.
Yeah. That kind of helped, but that's more of a long-term problem.
And well, you know, and that's the other conversation I had with, you know, with my management was, is this is like a self-correcting kind of thing, right? If I have to get up and go and the business can work without me and they're not affected by it, at some point, you know, I'm on my own time if I get up and go. And at some point there will come a path where the lines cross for my community service and my need to feed and eat my family and what have you, that I'll show back up at work.
Yeah. Aries is not an official first responder type organization
that
carries any clout at all, anywhere with anyone officially.
Yeah.
Everything is what you can work out. Pretty much what you can work out yourself.
Yeah. Yeah.
Jeff, you're getting farther and farther from that microphone. Are you a CW operator?
But you know, I also have an ID card for Los Angeles County Sheriff's Department. And their volunteer unit, it does say volunteer on it too. So that holds a little bit more, that might hold a little bit more clout. But I think if I were going to activate, I wouldn't activate with Sheriff's Department. They all know, both organizations know that, you know, my role, the reason I went there was hopefully to do some more interoperability and liaisoning with that group and understand their processes and procedures. And if they have an issue and Aries doesn't, then I would go. But otherwise, Aries is my primary reporting. And I held off for a long time in getting that ID. They've wanted me to join them for some time.
I had one serious out of the local area deployment. It was when Hurricane Isabel went through 2004 or 5, somewhere in there.
Yeah, it was Labor Day weekend, that was.
Yeah, it hit the eastern part of the state. You had to go about 75, 80 miles to hit the power, the zone where the power went out. And then my deployment was another 50, 60 miles beyond that. And again, I had freelance work, but as Jeff said, it was Labor Day weekend. I didn't have anything immediate, so I was able to get 3 or 4 days to go do something. And so I did. I piled stuff in the car real quick and headed out. I got instructions enough that said, head east, and we'll tell you what to do while you're on the road.
Yeah, get on the talking frequency when you get close, right?
Yeah. Well, I mean, yeah, I had frequencies to work with, and I had 75-meter mobile, which was handy. So I got my deployment as I was going. There was something that worried me about it, and it worries me to this day. They had one county that needed communications between the police department, the fire departments, and their 911 center, and that's where I ended up going. There was another county that had gone dark. They had not heard anything from anybody in that county in 24 hours.
Mm-hmm.
And I thought, I've got an HF mobile. I can drive up to the front of their EOC and say, I'm here to save the day. And I thought that would have been really great, but that's not where they sent me. And as far as I know, they didn't send anybody else. So I kind of wish that I had gone there, but I went where they told me to go. Not like what all the good guys on TV do in the cop shows, which is go where they think this is the best place to go.
Right. And from my experience working with the first responders, the last person they want to see is the guy that comes and says, I'm here to save the day.
But it was very useful. It was a learning experience for me. The 911 center was one in a converted bank branch. And they had no radios there. They had a couple of handy talkies. And no antennas. They had a satellite antenna on the roof, and it wasn't working. Some sporadic phone service was working in town, but not much. And all of their two-way communications went out by phone line to a tower that the height above average terrain of the antennas on that tower was a foot.
Yeah.
Because it had gone down.
Oh, no.
Kaboom. And so nothing was, no communications. So I, first step was they were using a repeater in a neighboring county, a ham repeater that was on the air. And, so I set up a handy talkie and the dispatcher could talk to the fire departments through that repeater. Well, I set about getting an antenna up on the mast that had the satellite antenna on it. It was the only thing sticking up in the air anywhere nearby. And I got that set up there, and I brought in a radio that was jeeped to the police frequencies, and I set up simplex, and their police cars were driving around town talking simplex. No radios at the dispatch center, so I set up my own radio to do that. You might ask, where were the two-way shop guys that were supposed to be fixing all this stuff? Fix it! They were searching for towers. They were combing the county for other towers that they could steal an antenna and a feline and put their repeaters on. So they were busy. So they were very happy when they finally came in and saw this ham who was doing all this stuff, getting communication set up to the dispatcher and the cars driving around town. We couldn't reach the furthest ends of the county, but we could reach the guys in the city where the population was.
Right.
So they said, who are you and what are you doing? And thank you for doing it. And
that's,
of course,
pretty good.
They were hams. Of course.
They were. They were.
But they were not active in any of the Aries stuff. They're, just inactive, but they were licensed.
Well, that's cool.
They sort of understood what was going on. I thought,
and hopefully they learned enough that maybe next time they'd step up and help.
Well, they were busy. I mean, it wasn't like they were sitting home waiting to get called. They were searching for towers.
Towers. Got
Coming
it.
The county. Where can we get a signal to? and a transmitter back on the air to get our system going. And I was there for 72 hours, and they got their system back on the air. The building that housed their repeaters was not destroyed. So they got a truck and put the repeaters in it, took to another tower, hooked it back up, stole some two-way business, cement plant or something, took them off the air and put their system on and got on the air.
Nice.
So, pretty cool.
Nice.
That was my big deployment.
Wow.
And I learned a lot. So anything else, you guys?
No.
I think I'm good.
It's nice to meet David.
David, yeah, it was good. This was a good episode.
You monitoring Facebook?
I am. There's we hit 12 at the top. There's about 5 left, and some of the folks think there's some weird issue with my video being lagging behind. But I think it's me being on the left coast.
It's Skype, Twit has been having a terrible problem with a few of their hosts. Where Skype, the newest version of Skype, has got a sync issue between audio and video.
Mm. Well, that's what Mark Cartwright was saying.
Yeah.
Does he say how much?
He said a little bit. It didn't exactly say. Let's see.
On Twit with some of their
about
hosts.
About a half second.
Yeah, it's Japanese movie.
Mm-hmm.
It's, well, now I'm talking. And now I'm now here's the translation.
Yes, exactly.
So Skype is free.
All right, well, hey, next time you have something break and you guys are going to fix it, roll the video live and call me up.
We'll
do a real we'll do smoke and solder live.
Yeah.
We really should do something on surface mount for the ham shack, what people can do in their home with circuit mount.
Now the question is, can you set it up here on this table?
I think so.
Okay, then we're good to go.
Get out your toaster oven. You can do it right there.
Sorry, George. Okay. We're stealing smoke and solder from you. Not forever.
We'll just have to call it something else.
And Randy.
Actually, I have an oscilloscope I'd like to show too. It's got no screen on it. Uses your PC. It's a small box, not as expensive as a full featured scope, but it's pretty doggone good. It goes to 250 megahertz under $1,000, and it's a USB cable to a PC. So you got a 250 megahertz scope with a 14-inch screen or whatever size your monitor is for $1,000.
Is the computer just being a monitor?
Yep.
It's not doing any processing of the signal?
Nope.
No DSP or anything?
All done in the little blue oscilloscope box.
Yeah, cool. There was wasn't a scope. It was a spectrum analyzer in QST a couple issues back that they're getting somewhat affordable, sub $1,000.
Yeah.
It went to, I think it went to 1.5 gigahertz.
Wow.
Which for me would not be useful at all because, it'd be partially useful, but you want something that is going to look at third harmonics at least, and is better to go to fourth and fifth harmonic to see how well a transmitter is going to be working. And a 70 centimeter transmitter is going to go up to, several gigahertz. So a 1 gigahertz spectrum analyzers, it'll show you third harmonic at 2 meters. That's sort of useful. But the test equipment is getting better and cheaper like everything else. Electronics is.
Remind me to show you the spectral mode on my scope. Build in.
So the title would be Smoke and Bismuth.
Okay, that would be good.
Or Smoke and Mirrors.
I like the bismuth.
Yeah. Well, because it's all secret stuff that understand.
Yeah, that's what we need to do is remove the mystery, the shroud of mystery from it.
All right. Ham Radio Now is brought to you by you. Somebody.
Can I hold the pig for you while you do that?
Yeah, here's got the stone pig. Yeah, there you go.
Yeah. Somebody on, I don't know if it was the Facebook page, if it was on YouTube, a lot of comments on a couple of recent shows, and someone was saying that the begging for funding foundation stuff was rubbing them the wrong way. They liked the Ham Radio Now is brought to you by you. Just see Arvin. So what I said was that the begging for funding and the Bob Heil stuff that we've been needling him is going to run its course. It's got a limited lifetime, and so we may be done with that. So, okay, we'll make him happy. Ham Radio Now is brought to you by you. If you enjoy the programs and get something out of them, all this equipment that is, are you surrounded by what seems to be a lot of expensive equipment, Jeff?
Oh, this is high tech stuff here.
Yeah. And, and it costs a lot of money and it's aging. Some of it's going to need replacing soon. So, well, not this year, but within a couple of years. And I bought this stuff based on the guy that's behind Jeff, that roaming gnome thing. Mm-hmm. You know, that was back when I did that that voiceover, and that earned me a lot of money. But that's all spent. That's gone. I get Social Security, and that's a little bit. The only reason I can live on Social Security is I don't pay rent. Cindy provides the housing for free, more or less. Pay for some utilities and stuff and food and stuff like that. But that's the only way I can. And I'm not, I got a 401k, which of course, like everybody else back in 2008, became a 201k. And I'm not having to touch that yet. But I'm seriously, the money I get from you guys is the money I live on. So it's, you know, Jeff has a real job. It doesn't pay what he's worth.
Thank you.
David has a real job. He's overpaid.
Mm-mm.
Just mm-mm. Seeing if you're paying attention, that's all.
I'm paying attention.
All right. So if you guys send a lot of money, I'll give some to David. We're holding our own.
We'll invest in the West Coast studio.
Right. Yeah. So we're brought to you by you, hamradionow.tv. That is it for this episode. We have just the right amount of people to close it off. I'm Gary Pierce, KN4AQ. Jeffy.
Jeff Wittich, AC4ZO.
David Goldenberg, W0DHG.
Over.
And
out.
He is lagging.
Yeah.
Am I?
I think it's a problem that's in between the keyboard and the chair.
I'll work on it.
Oh, okay. So you
want to do that again?
We'll do this again.
Okay.
I am Gary Pierce, KN4AQ.
Jeff Wittich, AC4ZO.
David Goldenberg, W0DHG. Over.
And
out. That worked fine. Jeff, did you enjoy being on Facebook Live?
Oh, yes. Yes. First time live.
We're not monitoring the chat. There is some potential chat going on there. But
I was, and there's a little bit here and there.
Yeah.
Wow. Something weird happens with the Facebook chat sometimes, where like it starts off as one, you know, you're live and recording and I jump in there, and then I didn't close the window. I didn't change somewhere else, but there's somewhere now there's a second thread and a second stream, and there's a whole bunch of people talking in there that I'm not talking to. I think actually this time I think I stayed in there.
I don't know how Facebook works.
Towards the end.
Do you know how Facebook works, Jeff?
No.
I have no clue.
Sometimes I go on there and read some messages, but I'm just looking for jokes. I never find any I can use in a class, though.
We're still live there.
We're still live. We're still recording, too. We finish the show, and then the audience has come to expect that we give them more.
There you go. Do you want to hear a joke that's suitable for a classroom?
Sure.
It's it has to offend no one to be safe. These two rather posh ladies were sitting in church one day, and they're doing all the church stuff, stand up and sit down and sing the songs and say the words offended. And all. And now pretty soon the sermon starts, so they settle in on the bench there to listen to the sermon, but after about 20 minutes, the preacher's still preaching the sermon, and one leans over to the other and says, "Geez, he's been talking so long, I think my butt's gone to sleep." And the other one said, "I know, I've heard it snoring 3 times.
Yep. You got, there's a good joke for a technical audience. Did I tell you this, or did you tell me this? It's at the two Adams walking down the street.
I may have told you, or you may have told me.
And one of them he
splattered all over.
Yeah, he had hard landing. And the other one looks at him and says, "Are you okay?" And the first one says, I think I lost an electron. And the second one says, are you sure? And the guy who fell said, I'm positive.
Oh, that was good. That was good.
Good one.
But you got to be a technical audience to get that.
Yes.
Ham or physics or something.
Yeah.
Big Bang Theory audience.
Every year, that joke gets less and less reaction and more blank stares.
What? Who? Now he's positive? How does he know?
Now I got to go put this back in the car.
All right.
All right. Well, good luck with that. Thank you, guys. It was fun.
First thing I thought when that ringing was happening was because I had the control cable out and, you know, did I have it grounded and all that stuff? Right. But I checked and it was.
The crimp it or something. Yeah.
Yeah. It was all the way it had been. Yep. So I don't know.
I'm still going to go back to the first year level one help desk guy. Can you please perform a factory reset?
I'll give that a try. First, I need to get the cable and software and it's mostly memories.
That's what's going to ask for a radio like that. It's just your presets, right?
Yeah. There's when you're
probably not a whole lot else in there. That's an all band.
Yep. It's, there's five. We're looking at this little ABC.
Well, we can't see thing. It.
Oh, I put a monitor here so I could tell what I was doing.
We're looking at your thumb, Gary. There you
so,
go.
So A, B, C, D, and E, and each of those has 100 potential memories in them. I don't have them anywhere near all full up, but
right.
I think E is what I. Anybody recognize this frequency?
Channel 185, channel 19.
Channel 19. Anybody recognize this frequency?
No.
In the CB world, there's this thing called import radios or 10-meter radios that the CBers get. And either they come ready to go outside the 40 channels or you clip a resistor or a wire or something. This radio has had its diode removed. You did it, remember?
No, but okay.
Yeah. I mean, we did it, we did it to get back on the middle 60-meter channel when they changed it. When this radio came.
That I do remember.
Yeah, this radio came programmed for the five 60-meter channels, and then they changed one. And ICOM said,
no, no,
can't change it. It's not a not a field programmable radio. If you clip this diode, it'll operate on the other channel plus every place else.
Yeah, that's right. And everywhere else you can get into trouble, right?
So these CB radios, they look like ordinary CB radio, but they've got an A, B, C, D, E switch on them. And you can switch from A to B, and now you've got 40 channels that are somewhere else in the spectrum. And channel 19...
From somebody else's country, huh?
Yeah, well, I don't know. But if you're on channel 19 on the A switch, you're on channel 19, 27185. Switch it to B, which is the easiest thing to switch, you're on 28085. And if you listen on that frequency... When 10 meters is open, which isn't much anymore, you will hear some CB-ish activity on that frequency. What you'll also hear is a lot of high-power RIDI, because a bunch of high-power RIDI guys know what the CBers are doing. And so as soon as the band comes up and that stuff starts, their kilowatt RIDI goes on there and kind of shuts them back down. You know what they do?
Turn it up.
C.
Oh, C. To go another.
I don't know what is that?
900 kilohertz.
I have no idea.
Yeah, 900 kilohertz.
Yeah, I wrote a cool article about that for the Sarah Repeater Journal more than a decade ago, called "Anatomy of an Incursion." I went out. What happened is a local guys, a local fox hunting team, actually identified somebody who was. who was doing that on that channel.
He saw him in a truck talking on the radio while he was listening to that frequency. Yeah. I think
they DF'd their way enough to be in the right neighborhood. Oh. So it was a fleet of cement trucks or dump trucks.
Right.
And so they identified him. They turned him into Riley. Yeah. Riley sent him a note. Back in those days, when Riley sent somebody a warning letter or whatever, the address and name and everything got published. So I looked him up, called the guy, said, "You got this warning letter, right?" "Yeah, and I don't know what to do." So tell you what, I'm a journalist. I did the repeater journal. I was sort of a journalist. I'm also a ham. I'm very familiar with this stuff. I'll come and help you out if you'll talk to me about what you did. So I show up there, take his picture. Sure, that's no problem. Picture of his radio. He showed me all this stuff. "Do you know anything about what's going on when you throw these switches?" "No, somebody just sold me the radio." "Okay, here's how to answer Riley." And wrote up the story. And he pointed me to a CB shop where he got the radio. And so I went over to the CB shop. And the guy is all kinds of paranoid until I say, "Well, listen, I'm a ham." And he is a ham. "And I'm writing this article, but I won't say where I am or who you are, but let's just talk about it." And he filled me in a lot of this background on the import radios. I'm pretty much certain it's still going on. Nothing's really changed.
Yeah.
Well, yeah, I mean, that's everywhere. We went and had our... we got passports for our vacation to Italy, and in the post office, in the passport agency, they had blue Baofengs, you know, UV5Rs, and they were using it for internal communications in the post office.
Yeah.
That's your federal government.
Yep.
And I wanted to say something, and then I thought, you know, I just want to get out of this place, because we were there for hours in line.
There was a Reddit thread on that, and the people that they found were actually using it in the ham band.
I didn't even look.
Yeah. And so what they wanted to do is offer them an alternative. And people were coming up with potential alternatives that, apparently it was more distance than an FRS radio would cover. But, by the way, something that we haven't talked about yet, but that I've been looking for a long time, and then it kind of snuck by earlier this year, is the FCC has changed the Part 95 rules on FRS and GMRS.
Save that for a show. We talked about that. We talked about it briefly when it came up.
Okay.
And I think I said the same thing then. I said, save it for a show. And not that I don't want to talk to you about it now, Jeff and Gary, but
time to go.
That's a show.
You got dinner too, right? Coming up.
I'm sure the kids will come out here and bug me at some point.
Okay.
Well, it's my Tucky's time. And then some.
All right. Well, that was our ham radio now little extra. The Facebook extra. So, bye, everybody. You don't get the over and out again because this is just the Facebook click-off time, which I can't do because Jeff is sitting in front of the computer and he doesn't know how to do it. So, you'll see me walk over there.
You could tell me.
Well, do a Alt-Tab until Facebook shows up someplace. Oh, it might not ever. It's probably on a Chrome tab. Do Alt tab until Chrome shows up someplace.
Okay, done.
And now click on the Facebook tab. It's in the middle monitor. It's our fix it guy. Fix it.
Click on what tab?
Facebook tab.
We got Facebook.
Oh no.
There we go.
That's where we can look at Facebook, but that's not where we can dialogue. I can't tell him how to do it. It's way too complicated. Go back
on over there.
Go back to the Skype tab and hang up on David.
Bye bye. I'll hang up for you. Okay. You guys have a good one.
Okay.
7-3.
Okay. Bye. All right.
Okay. Mm-hmm. So now, Alt tab until you get on the Wirecast.
Let's see. How do I recognize Wirecast?
You'll have our pictures in the middle of it. It's looking like it's a possibility.
That one says display in the title bar.
Maybe it's the other one.
That one?
I can't really see. Yeah, there you go.
Okay.
Okay, now, up on the top, I can't see it. I thought I would switch it up, but but this is a limited view. Up on the top, there'll be two green lit things kind of side by side.
Yeah, I got a red, a green, and a green and a red.
Ew, I don't like anything that's red. Oh, sort of the upper left, very top and toward the left.
Okay, there's a green spot with a concentric ring about it, and the whole thing's inside a rectangle.
And what's to the left of that?
Looks like a Wi-Fi symbol.
Ah, okay, that Wi-Fi symbol, that'd be Facebook. Click that, and Facebook goes away.
Clicked it, but didn't see anything obvious.
Takes a moment.
Well, the green went away.
Yeah. And then the other one is the recording. You click that, and we'll stop recording.
That's this